in those early springtime, but the strike was on.
For several years, I have driven up and down Interstate 25, always admiring the east side of the scenic Sangre de Cristo Mountains. Between Trinidad and Walsenburg, Colorado, I would see this nondescript point of interest sign indicating the site of the Ludlow Massacre. What was the Ludlow Massacre? Was it where Indians had wiped out a group of white settlers or miners, or the site of an Indian village where soldiers attacked and killed its inhabitants? I had always been intrigued. One day, I decided to pull off the interstate and investigate. Settle the question once and for all. Boy, was I surprised at what I found. Hi, Wyoming traveler, and I'm here at the site of the Ludlow Massacre. And it wasn't what I thought. It wasn't a massacre of Indians by soldiers or settlers by Indians. What it was a massacre of miners by members of the Colorado militia and the private police of the Rockefeller Enterprise. I'll explain the story of this tragedy and what happened.
The story began in April 1914, actually the year before, in the coal mining area of south central Colorado, along the slopes of the Sangre de Cristo Mountains. The living and working conditions of miners in the first two decades of the 20th century were horrendous. Boys as young as 10 or 12 worked in the mines along with the fathers. The miners were paid about $1.60 per day, working a 10-hour shift. That is equal to about $46 in 2022. I say about because they were paid not by the hour, but by the amount of coal they actually dug. They were not paid for any time spent shoring up the mine or working on any other safety measures. There was no health insurance, life insurance, or workers' compensation for injury on the job. If a miner was hurt and could not work, he and his family were SOL. Living conditions for miners and their family were deplorable. One person described a mining town. The residents or houses and living quarters of the miners smack of dirtiest poverty. Practically all of the residents are huddled in the shadow of the coal washers and the smoke of the coke ovens, making the surroundings smutty with coal dust and coke smoke. Not all the houses are equipped with water, and practically none have sewage. They depend for their water upon hydrants on the streets. The people reflect their surroundings. Shantily dressed women and unkempt children throng the dirty streets and alleys of the camp. One is forced to conclude that these people must be very poorly paid, else they would not consent to live in this fashion. The company owned the town, the homes, the store, the school, boarding houses, and any other buildings. The company paid the salaries of not only the miners, but everyone else who worked in the community. Individuals had to rent their home or room from the company and buy all their goods from the company store. Frequently, the miners and other employees were paid in company scrip, and the only place to redeem the scrip was at the company store. The miners had repeatedly asked the company, Colorado Fuel and Iron Company, owned by John D. Rockefeller, for a pay increase and improvements in working conditions. Their requests or demands fell on deaf ears. As a side note, Rockefeller, at the time, was one of the richest men in the country. With no other recourse, in the summer of 1913, the miners went on strike. Because the miners lived in the company town, when they went on strike, they were evicted from their homes. For shelter, large tent camps were established along the range. One of these camps was established near the small railroad station and community called Ludlow. Once the strike started, relationships between the miners and the company security guards became tense. Gunfire was exchanged between the groups, and there were some deaths. At the urging of Rockefeller, the governor of Colorado called out the state militia. At night, the company guards would ride along the rail line above the tent city and fire into the camp. As a result, many tents had underground cellars dug in the floor. Tensions worsened. The militia set up a machine gun on a hill known as Water Tower Hill, which overlooked the camp. On the morning of April 20th, shooting started between the miners and the militia and the guards, which lasted all day. The following is an eyewitness account. 7 men and a boy were killed in the shooting. At least 3 of the men, all striking coal miners, one a leader, were apparently executed in cold blood by the Colorado National Guardsmen, who had taken them captive. As the sun set, the militia moved into the camp itself, and an inferno lit up in the darkening skies, reducing most of the makeshift village to ashes. It wasn't until the next morning that the bodies of 2 women and 11 children were discovered, where they had taken shelter in a dirt bunker beneath one of the tents. The raging fire had sucked the oxygen from the air below, suffocating the families as they hid from the gun battle. As the miners ran out of ammunition, they retreated into the hills. The militia then came into the camp and burned the tents. This dugout, 11 children and 2 women died. The information plaque helps in understanding the layout of the area. This is the location of the tent city. The militia placed their machine gun on this hill overlooking the encampment. In 1916, the United Mine Workers of America bought the site of the Ludlow Tent Encampment. 2 years later, they erected the monument to commemorate those who died during the strike. In all, 25 people were killed during the Ludlow Massacre, 3 of whom were National Guard troops.
Soldiers guarding the railroad bridge. Every once in a while, a bullet would fly, kick up gravel under my feet. We were so afraid you'd kill our children. Dug us a cave that's 7 foot deep. Carried our young ones and a pregnant woman down inside the cave. asleep. That very night you soldiers waited till all us miners was asleep. You snuck around our little tent town, soaked our tents with your kerosene.
It is here that 11 children and 2 women took shelter from the gunshots, only to die of suffocation when the tent city was burned. I'm going to turn the camera off as I walk down the stairs. Okay, the room is locked, so I can't go in it, but hopefully you can get a view of this room. I know my reflection is there.
The massacre at Ludlow received nationwide condemnation. Although the Ludlow Massacre outraged many Americans, the tragedy did little to help the beleaguered Colorado miners and their families. Additional federal troops crushed the coal miners' strike, and the miners failed to achieve recognition of their union or any significant improvement in their wages and working conditions. The conflict lasted until the end of the year. In all, 66 men, women, and children died during the strike known as the Colorado Cold War. I appreciate you taking time to watch this video. If you enjoyed this video and would like to see others like it, please like and subscribe to the channel.
Get the look on the faces. The men and women that awful day, when we stood around to preach their funeral, to lay the corpse of the dead away.